I wanted to ask you a little bit about the lenses. You said at the notebook you had, if I understood correctly, that you had a long discussion with the director about the lenses you were going to use, and these discussions were happening before the shooting. And I'd like to know a bit more about that.
That special case, it was that he had a kind of reflex, Janos, to change permanent the lens. Now let's do it with a long lens, with the short, with the wide angle, and so. And there I was against it, because I feel the organic thing from the room are very important subconscious information for our senses. If I change just like that, the wide fish eye, it's nothing else than a kind of, you know, like a spy in the door. You pack more information in the same frame. That means, in other words, everything becomes smaller. That's a light angle. And the long lens makes the opposite. And the normal lens makes approximately what our eye does. And then you still have a little range or to point out for a close-up or for a portrait. That's no problem. But you have not to lose, or you have to be conscious of all that effects, then you can use it. But very often, and if you look at TV or standard films, there's no conscience about that. And that makes me, you know, headache. And you lose the relation from a person to the background. How big is the room? How small is the room? If you would use wide angle in that small farmhouse, it would look terrible. It's just, you know, it's just, and that is on the side that people goes like that out of the way. And what for? Anyway, our brain puts together that puzzle. It's even more interesting to describe a room by partly, because the brain will build up your room depending on your participation in the movie. That I really learned in the work with Haneke, because he's a master in evoking things. At the White Ribbon, I was very often asked, especially in the States, by journalists, how you can shoot such cruel things. I said, which cruelty? You saw. You cannot prove me one. There is no cruelty shown. It happens in your brain, and this is the mastership. And I think for a camera work, this is a very, very big challenge to evoke, to just give the right amount of information that your brain continues. Then you are participant and not the board. Otherwise, you just sit there and you see everything. And that's why I hate establishing shots. Let's show first the room and then go in detail. So, right.
Which was your main lens for the notebook and second used or?
35-40.
Either 35 or 40.
Yeah, and sometimes 50. And it's not the dogma. You have some reason where it makes sense, mm-hmm. or you make a movement, or you change the lens. But it needs a good reason for that, not just for formal. To be not bored. And he had the tendency from his experience in his work before to change permanent lenses or to cover it. That I hate, because then it's just a decision which is later difficult on the editing place. But the problem stays the same.
Christian, one of the things that the film has which is really rare is this gravitas, but it's dealt with in such a naturalistic way. And in a way, you have answered a bit of the question about kind of moderation and how to step back and let things play out. But maybe a combination that you had to deal with here for our audience to learn about is how you deal with that with two young children. I know you've mentioned it before.
You do?
Two young children. To keep them protected, to keep them, and to then do your work, and be true to the script, but also be compassionate to young actors. Could you elaborate a little bit on that, please?
Thank you for that question. Yes, it's again no rule, of course, but with deaf kids, the problem was that you spoke only Hungarian and quite bad in Hungarian, or not at all. But then they showed me that their school books, they had to, I have to learn a few words in Hungarian, they learned a few words in German. Then they laughed to drive with a dolly. It took 1-2 hours, but it's worse to do that. So that means it's just a special way to create trust, which you need even with a big star. It's not only with kids. And how to create the trust depends on you, on the situation, on the partner. It's difficult to answer, but the trust is an important thing. And then they just forget. It's never a question, I tell you, I swear, it's not a question of the size of camera. Because many students said, I could shoot that only with a little handicap because there were kids on the set. This is ridiculous. They love the bigger machines as well, or you let them look through or handle them. It's it's really, or like some people, they start to just be too because it's kids on the set. They have no problem at all if you speak loud. They are harder than we are sometimes. So this is a game. But concrete, but they don't realize that, is that I try and I could, I think nearly all the time we had absolutely free sets. Not a cable, not a tripod, nothing. Very rarely some little tiny reflectors, so 10 to 20 centimeters somewhere on the roof. But that was rarely and not in their eyeline, yeah. So what stays, it's always the mic. They always look up to the mic. And the camera itself. And if they are a little familiar with that thing, and after a few days they play the profi, you know, they were coming from very bad social background and suddenly have own mobile home with their name on the door and they can drive dolly and everybody loves them and the mask is, but this is a shock. This is a real shock for kids like that. This is a bigger problem than the shooting itself. To integrate them slowly, step by step, in a situation from a shooting picture. And we took, and Janusz was very, very good to never psychological, leading the boys, not telling them, your grandma is now sick, you have to cry very soon. If you are able to cry, it doesn't work like that, of course. But suddenly they cry. Without any, they play with the football in front of the, the location, and then they come in and they cry. Kids and animals are the biggest enemies for any actor, anyway. Then to not disturb them, this is what I love anyway, to minimize the technique on a set. And then it's good for the kids as well. But it's not that this is... The only scene which was really... two scenes were difficult. The one was the... with the police guy, the torture scene, if I can say so. And there I realized, of course, they are not tortured. And of course, it's film blood. But we forget that for kids, playing is reality. They were really finished after that shooting. Because for them, it's reality, of course. Even if they don't slap them really, and so they feel like that because they're kids. That was really a hard thing. And the second scene was with the girl in the bus, the sex scene. And it's funny because when we were now on a different festivals, also the boys are there, each time the scene comes. I, for myself, I don't have, in 30 years, I have shit in here. But they were quite cool. And there we had to separate, of course, the orgastic thing, the girl was separated. But only the close-ups, and otherwise she was not acting. Also for her very difficult. But there I could create, I will show you then there's some pictures, where I could create really, the whole set was, I could hold the light for six hours, which was easily enough for the whole scene. And you could look out the windows, they could move around wherever they wanted. Each close-up was well lit, it was never anything extra. I can go to that scene if you want, or we continue
with some other things. Have a look.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
It's more spontaneous. So I'm already now a little in my light system, but it comes later more precisely, don't worry. So this is these are my parallel beamers, and there are placed the reflectors, and this was the location, these three windows, and one window from the courtyard side. And this was this one. You see there's the beamer up to the reflector into the room. So that was the whole installation. With some details. And like that we could, the crane was not yet correct placed here, but we could look out straight from the windows. We were never hindered by anything. And that was still the adjustment. And with the reflector you create the character from the as a hard to soft, and the light distribution as well, that's the main thing. You can decide which kind of light is distributed. You don't need flex or whatever to moderate the light. You do it by choosing the right reflector with the right qualities, or you add small reflectors to mix different qualities from the same, taking out from the same lighting. And that was the set. That's just screenshots from the dailies, no grading, nothing yet done. But sometimes you see the artifacts. And you see that's a very good example. It's if you have light in the room, it's too light there, and I have full information here. And as I can see, the projector is too strong. You have the organic falling down the light to the back side from the room. You have no mishmash in all the structures. See, look at Hamashoy. And you have a beautiful modulation on the skin, on the bodies from the boys as well, and on her back too. And that means not one light inside. That would ruin it. And no other reflector inside in that case. And you see all directions, or the modulations from here in the white. White is so difficult as a color, and you can handle it in fact only with to create as much white as possible, if I can say so. And to modulate in the, to give texture all over. And even that, you see the shadow characteristic, everything is defined by the right choice of the reflector. So the reflector is in fact the light source. And another effect which you can show here clearly, that you have double way, of course. The virtual light point is up here. That means the actor can come quite near to the window without burning out, and the curtains are not burning out, because the light doesn't come from this distance, it comes from here, up there. It's just simple physics. Like that you can control even the direction of the shadow, or if you have very low rooms, you can easily put the light higher, even if it's not possible. Yeah, this is the example for that scene. There are natural eye lights with the windows, it's no need to give them extra or something. Okay. You can leave the projector maybe if you want, but we go back to the light, please. Thank you. Maybe it's a good method to come from question to question and details, otherwise I just make the lecture there as well. Yeah.
Hello. I would like to ask you a question and maybe your thoughts on the subject. Going into the digital age, we have this thing called color grading, which has taken off to a new art. What is your relationship with a color grader? Do you allow the freedom of an artist, or do you follow from the beginning of the shooting till the end product with your strategy or structure?
If it's not the person I'm used to work with, we fight. Because they always want to correct. It's their sickness. I have too my sicknesses, but in that case, they are sick. They say, it's too much, too low. No, forget it. It's done for that. I don't know if it was you or Fedon, we spoke yesterday, but I try to be as near as possible to the final look. Then you have the best information for that what you want. You can correct everything, but then you lose information, or you deform it. And nearer you are from beginning on, better it is. And that needs sometimes the time to, for example, here the grader, he was so delighted because he was inventing a special color space. And I was interested in that invention, but not for that movie, not in that movement, in that moment. But he forgot to go back to the raw material, for example. And then we had a few days to repeat, because it cannot be, it's not true. I know it's more there and less there and whatever. Until he went back, because then he could not use his invention. So it's always that kind of fights, which was, I don't cry back for the analog time at all, because we have really so much better and richer possibilities now. And even when we were used to shoot on film still, since let's say 2000 or something was a normal standard to make grading digitally from the scan. Because the scan was not on the level than today, the tools were not as developed. Another risk is that the menus are too big. I don't want to know all the possibilities, I want to see my vision. And this is a risk for yourself, what you could do there and there and there. It's very risky if the director starts to do that. Or he said, on my laptop I had last time that and that, and then the searching and the contrast is ruined or whatever. This is more that kind of problems today. But to find the possibilities are great. And the colorist has to serve the story and the material as I have to serve the story.